Welcome back to the Weekly Show with Trevor McManus. Joining me today is a journalist and hockey writer for the San Jose Mercury News. You can find him on the company website, mercurynews.com, or on Twitter, at Pollak on Sharks. He is the San Jose Sharks beat writer, David Pollak. David, thank you for joining me today.
Thanks for the invitation.
The one thing that I've noticed is that there's a lot of hockey writers who may not be or may show a certain bias and definitely turn a blind eye when they're discussing their team. As a beat writer for the Sharks, how do you put your feelings aside for the team and the players?
What I think almost any beat writer will tell you is that, and I think because it's true, what you're really rooting for is a three-goal lead going into the third period because you're writing on deadline and you don't need to have games go south on you. You like to have a consistent game where the team's up going into the third period, you're writing while you're trying to watch at the same time. I think most beat writers are professional enough to be rooting for the story and rooting for themselves and not carrying any kind of bias for the team one way or the other.
I've traveled a lot during the playoff time in British Columbia, and during playoffs, there's a whole aura that surrounds the province once the Vancouver Canucks make the playoffs. What's it like in San Jose? Can you describe the mood there, as well as can you notice the feeling of playoffs before you get inside the HP Pavilion?
Actually, it's different down here. Inside the building, that's as good a place to watch a hockey game as you're going to find in the NHL. The crowd is pumped. It's passionate. It's a noisy place. That said, you don't feel it as much outside the rink as you do when you're in Vancouver or any of the Canadian cities. It's obviously, you know, a lot of us were talking, we like the idea of coming up to Canada for the first round of the playoffs because you feel like you're a part of something much bigger. And yeah, we get to be part of the media circus that goes on up there all the time.
As everyone should know, the San Jose Sharks and the Vancouver Canucks met in the third round of the 2011 playoffs. Were you there covering the team then?
Yes, I was.
And what was the experience like for you? When I was watching dressing rooms and post games in certain markets, and I only see a few reporters there, it's almost foreign to me because I'm so used to having, you know, 5, 10 reporters in the room for the Canucks. So what's it like going into the fray and joining what you described as a circus of reporters?
I don't mean to sound like that. That's not me suggesting everybody's a bunch of clowns. It's just that the crowding, the impossibility of trying to get access to some of the scrums, it's a pretty good challenge for those of us who are used to having the players to ourselves a little bit more. There are basically two of us who cover the Sharks on a regular basis, home and away, and there are probably another half dozen who show up for the home games here. So it's a much different environment. And I'm not saying that's not me complaining. It really is exciting to be part of it up there.
We're speaking with San Jose Sharks beat writer David Pollak. Follow him on Twitter, at Pollak on Sharks. David, can you take us back to last Tuesday? The Sharks took the game against Dallas 3-2. Was there a sense of relief there when they officially made the playoffs? Or was it, let's move on to our ultimate goal here, next target?
No, I think there was a sense of relief because it was anything but a sure thing. And I think it was March 24th, the team had fallen out of the top eight. They were still in what seemed to be free fall. They were showing really no signs of the kind of spirited hockey they played at the beginning of the season. They'd gone about 7 weeks with, I think it was, 2 regulation wins and maybe 6 overall wins in something like 23 games. It was not fun hockey to watch, and I'm sure they weren't having much fun in the room either. But they were able to turn things around. They were able to make some moves strategically and personnel-wise, and got in, I guess it was the 46th game of the season, they qualified for the playoffs. So there was some relief, but there was also the usual realization in San Jose where it's kind of expected to get in the playoffs. There was the realization that the real work is still ahead. It wasn't we're happy to be here, we can go home now. They know it gets more serious now. The expectations down here are still pretty high.
Let's move on to Logan Couture. He scored the game winner to clinch the playoffs this season for the Sharks. What's it been like for you to watch his ascension from Calder Trophy finalist to leading the team in points and really becoming an elite player?
Yeah, he's pretty amazing to watch, and there's an aspect to his game that I think people are going to start discovering if they pay a little closer attention. He's become a really strong defensive player, too. He's in all three zones. He's right in the middle of things, and he's getting the job done. I had to look this up myself. I kind of surprised it. We knew he had been blocking some key shots during the season. A couple games left, I went to one of the stat charts, sorted it out by block shots. The only NHL forward with more block shots than Logan Couture is Ryan Callahan of the New York Rangers. Couture, I think, has finished with 51, and that's more than any other forward in the Western Conference. And I think that's an aspect of his game that's going to surprise some people.
Another player who's come up in the ranks is Annti Niemi. Last season, he had a 9.15 save percentage, 2.42 goals against. He had both of those trend in the right direction this season with a 9.24 save percentage and a 2.16 goals against. How has he picked up his game so easily?
I think it was mostly off-season conditioning, and I think the lockout is nobody liked the lockout. Everybody hated the lockout. But Niemi made good use of it. He played in about 10 games in Finland, and then he came back to the States and brought his goalie coach with him. And they were working out. The Sharks, several of the skaters were running ice time on a regular basis here, and they'd get together, and Niemi would be with them. And then when everybody else left, one or two would stay behind and work with him and his goalie coach. So he really put a lot of time in. I think agility is improved. I think he's much quicker to get up off the ice when he's down. He seems to be more focused than he was last season.
On the line is the journalist from the San Jose Mercury News. Check out his work on www.mercurynews.com. David, another player that we should talk about quite a bit here is Ryan Clowe. He was a character guy with grit and just a huge SOB. How much are the Sharks going to miss Clowe during this playoff run?
It's a good question. It's also a tricky question to answer because not that Ryan Clowe was the problem, not that Douglas Murray was the problem, not that Michael Hanzus was the problem, but when Doug Wilson traded those three guys, the Sharks became a faster team and the Sharks became a better team. They're going to miss Clowe's toughness. They're going to miss the sense of protection that he provided players out there. They brought in a guy that you guys know probably better than we do down here with Rafi Torres, and what they're trying to be polite because no one wants to say anything bad about Ryan Clowe, and rightfully so. But Rafi Torres brings an element of that with speed that Clowe didn't. And so they think they're covered on that aspect of the game and have actually had an upgrade.
Media types around the league have suggested that the Canucks are the world's most hated team, at least in the NHL, we'll say. How are the Canucks perceived by the Sharks and their faithful?
It's hard to know how they're perceived by the team. The team, maybe it's not so hard because actually after that last playoff series, a lot of players were open that they really disliked the Vancouver Canucks. And, of course, you focus on guys like Alex Burrows and you focus on guys like Maxime LaPierre when you're talking like that. But there seemed to be some genuine bad blood between the teams. I don't think it was sort of the wrestling-oriented hype that you get sometimes. You got the feeling the guys were sincere. We'll see how much that carries over to this series. But a little bit of the same for the fans. It was interesting last time. Somehow there was a really large delegation of Vancouver Canuck fans inside HP Pavilion. And it's obvious that some Sharks fans were selling tickets on the market, and they were purchased by people coming down from Vancouver. And the people really resented that. I mean, there was this sort of, how did we let that many of these people get in our building? And it became, sort of a home away from home for Vancouver. It was much too comfortable a place to play.
Yeah, it's Canuck Nation. They're all over the place. You got to watch out for them.
It's a quick airplane ride. I understand how that works.
In the 2010-2011 season, the Sharks had a winning percentage of nearly 60%. This season, it's hovering around 52%. What's the biggest difference, in your opinion, between the San Jose Sharks of 2013 and the Sharks of 2011?
I think that's a really good question. Like, give me a minute here to try to wrap my brain around it. This year's team took a lot longer to kind of come together. The first 5-6 games were an aberration. The Sharks rolled over everybody, including the Canucks, in that stretch. Then they kind of settled into what do we really have here? And they looked around, and they didn't really have people in the right positions. Guys were playing out of position, either too high or too low. Nothing was quite gelling. Everything kind of started clicking here when they moved Brent Burns to a forward position, and that was sort of an act of desperation because they needed something to spark the offense, but it worked incredibly well. He ended up with 20 points in 24 games. So by moving Burns into a forward position, they could move Pavelski to a third line. It took them a lot longer to get everybody in the right place this time. They seemed to be, in 2010-11, they were still riding high, and they were, didn't have as many question marks about themselves. They had more confidence then. It took a while to find that confidence.
I'm speaking with the San Jose Sharks beat writer, David Pollak. Follow him on Twitter, at Pollak on Sharks. David, this is probably a loaded question, but what makes the Sharks so good at the HP Pavilion?
Yeah, they were, you know, you can't get a straight answer out of the players. They kind of, you know, play it down that they're not really any different home or away. But they obviously had a terrific record there this year. I don't know whether it was the crowds got the other teams off their game or whether the, you know, the Sharks got pumped up. But like I said, it's a really good place to play hockey, and when the building's buzzing in there, and they didn't seem to be doing anything fancy. They just seemed to be playing the same kind of solid road game they wanted to, but the results were better at home.
Only one player on both teams, being Henrik Sedin, was in the top 30 in NHL scoring in the regular season this year. That leads me to believe that the series could be a defensive battle. How do you see the series playing out?
Yeah, I think that's a reasonable way to look at it. The Sharks, you know, would have an occasional game where they get four or five goals, but for the most part, they were winning 3-2 and 2-1 games, and I don't think that's going to change a whole lot here. I know they'd like to. They like to sort of get inside the Canucks goalies' heads, you know, by throwing a lot of pucks into the net, and that would maybe stir up the whole Schneider-Luongo thing, presuming that Schneider's healthy. But I'm not sure that's going to happen. That's sort of not the nature of these teams, this year at least. They've both been much more offensive-oriented in the past.
And so, I hate to do it, but can you give me a prediction?
You know, I can give you a guess. I don't think it's a prediction, because I don't have enough confidence in my own ability to figure out what's going to happen on a hockey rink. But I'm going to give you a guess, and I'm going to say Sharks in six.
He is a man who's been on the beat for the San Jose Sharks for years. He's a writer at the Mercury News. Check out all of his work on the company website, www.mercurynews.com. Follow him on Twitter, at Pollak on Sharks. Mr. David Pollak, thanks for joining me today.
My pleasure.
That's going to do it for another edition of the weekly show with Trevor McManus. Next week, we'll have a special Mother's Day episode. We'll see you there.